Previously on OAKS Online.
Is that happiness is in the happenings, but joy is in Christ.
Survival or not survival?
Oh, what are we doing by here? Come out!
Hey, I'm Josh.
It's series 6.
Wow.
I'm Jack.
Why are we back here?
New series.
Got lost.
We've been staying for the winter and we're back ready for the new series.
It feels good to be back
on OAKS Online
once again, and it's good to have you here, folks.
Very good, very good.
Lots coming up today. This is what we've got coming up today.
This next interview has been greatly anticipated by many people at the OAKS for a long time. Josh, who are we interviewing now?
Drum roll, please. Dorothy Higgins.
Yes!
Ladies and gents, this is the TV event of the year.
Yes.
This is insane.
Best interview of the series so far, I think.
I agree.
Of Series 6, yeah.
Cue the interview. Dorothy, it is fantastic to have you here.
Really is. I'm honoured to be here.
I've been looking forward to this very much. So much to talk about. Where should we begin?
I think we should begin right at the start of your Christian journey. So Dorothy, how did you come to know Jesus?
Well, that's a little bit difficult to say because I can't give you a date or a time.
Okay.
I was brought up in a Christian home and I only have a vague memory of not being quite sure how God felt about me. But I don't have any memory of never wanting to follow God. I don't have any memory of not loving God because I was brought up to love God and to obey God. I can only just remember thinking, well, I'm not sure how he feels about me. But certainly by the age of 8, I was sure that Jesus loved me. And I remember having a children's hymn book, an illustrated book that somebody had given me. And I remember pointing out to my mum, this is my favourite hymn. And it was the one with the chorus, I am so glad that Jesus loves me. So I think my mum accepted that. I'm not sure my dad was quite convinced that I really understood. And in fact, because I knew, you know, when you were Christian, you took communion at church. So I asked if I could take communion. Well, that wasn't a thing that any children did at our church because it was a little bit formal. Anyway, my parents asked at the church meeting. And the answer came back, no, you're too young to understand. Which left me in a little bit of a no man's land, really, for some years. And it rather shut me down because I thought, well, if I'm not believed, what's the point of saying anything? So for quite a number of years, I just kept quiet and didn't say anything.
Yeah.
But I think once I got to my teens, and I was going with on young people's weekends, and I then sort of plucked up the courage to say something. And I think from then on, I started to grow more as a Christian.
Absolutely.
But I always was sure.
What age did you get baptised?
Oh, well, I didn't get baptised for a long time because our church didn't actually have adult baptism. So I didn't. I was what we call christened as a baby, because a lot of people in my church that I grew up in were more like of the Anglican persuasion, although it wasn't an Anglican church. So I was christened as a baby. But I actually did undergo adult baptism when I belonged to a Baptist church, but that wasn't till I was in my 30s.
Oh, amazing. Yeah. Well, there you go. So as someone who's, as you say, known Jesus for pretty much all your life, have you ever had an interesting encounter with Jesus?
Yes, I would say so. When I was 16, I used to go each Easter on a young people's house party. Very rough accommodation it was. One cold tap for 70 of us up in a little village in North Yorkshire. And we used to have a great time, but it was very rough and ready. Often it snowed while we were up there. And but we had a great time and real good fellowship. I remember the second year I went, coming back on the coach, I thought, I'm not sure it's been quite as good as it was the first year.
Yeah.
And I remember saying to God, coming back on the coach, God, I don't want to come back the same as I went. And I didn't feel anything at the time, but for about a week after I got back, I just couldn't get enough of reading my Bible or praying, and it almost felt like I was in a constant conversation with God. And it was like being in the sunshine, and the minute it felt like the sun had gone behind a cloud, I'd say, oh Lord, why have I lost that sense of your presence? And God had shown me if I'd thought about something or done something that had displeased him, and it was like the sun coming out again. And for a whole week it was like that, and even my parents noticed a difference. And I remember my dad saying to me one evening at the end of that week, it's been a pleasure having you in the house, dear. And I thought, oh, at long last, he really thinks I am a Christian.
I love that.
So, yeah, that was my first experience of really sensing the Lord's presence with me in a really strong way. In fact, I've described it as like having one foot in heaven for a week. It was so powerful. And there's been other times since when God's come to me in a really strong way.
So Dorothy, you said that lasted for a week, but what about when you don't feel like that? How does God affect you in your everyday life?
Yes, it's certainly not always like that. And there's times when I don't feel like I'm hearing God's voice. And I think it's at times like that when you've really got to trust God. And sometimes it's almost like God's hiding because he wants you to trust him and trust what he says in his word, that he says he's always with us, doesn't he? And he says he'll never ever leave us. And sometimes it's almost like he's saying, do you really believe that? I'll just hide and see if you really trust me. You know, that I've said I won't believe you. Even if you can't feel me, do you still believe that? Because he doesn't want us just to rely on our feelings.
Yeah.
He wants us to believe his word. And when he says he'll never leave us, do we really believe that? Yeah, so sometimes it's a case of just trusting his word. So yeah, sometimes, you know, you can go for weeks, months, you know, whole long span of time, when you feel like, where are you, God?
Yeah.
But that's when you just have to hang on and trust him. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dorothy, picture the scene. You're okay. In a magical hotel. You've just woken up. Lovely morning.
Yeah.
The sun is shining through the windows.
Amen.
You go downstairs and breakfast is provided. But, as I say, this is a magical hotel.
Oh, yes.
You can have any breakfast you like. What's your ideal breakfast?
Ideal breakfast. Well, if I've got plenty of time, I could eat a full full English breakfast.
Good choice.
Like
plenty of mushrooms on it, mind you.
Lovely.
What cereal?
Oh, forget the cereal. No. Forget the cereal. I'll just go straight into the full English.
Yeah.
And plenty of orange juice, fresh orange juice.
Good choice. Yeah. Prefer orange juice over apple juice?
Oh, definitely.
Oh,
yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. Freshly squeezed orange juice.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I disagree with you there, but I like the breakfast choice. And would you go for black pudding or not?
Oh, no. Forget the black pudding.
No black pudding.
No.
Fair enough.
Mind you, if you're in Scotland and you get a chance to have haggis with it, yes, go for that.
I like haggis. Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Lovely. Lovely. That's a good choice.
Good choice. Yeah. Okay. So, Dorothy,
yes.
On Sunday, you came up and spoke a little bit about how you're going to China in a few weeks.
Yeah.
Could you tell us a bit more about this, please?
Right, well, I've got two lots of friends that live in China.
Mm.
They're people who came over and studied here, and while they were here, they lived with my father. And so we got to know them very well. In fact, one of them, I went over when she had her wedding in China. So we know them very well, and we've kept up the friendship. So one of them lives in Shanghai, and that's the one whose wedding I went to, and the other one lives in Beijing, in the capital. So they've both been asking me if there was any chance that I'd go over and see them. They've been over here previously, and in fact I have been over there and stayed with them before. So I've been asking God if I was meant to do any more travelling. And recently somebody who knew that I was wanting to travelling actually said they felt prompted by God to give me some money to help me go travelling. So I thought, thank you God, that's a good sign that I'm meant to do some travelling. And as China was on my heart, I thought probably that's where I'm meant to go with this money, use this money to go. Just before Christmas, I rang these friends to wish them Happy Christmas and talk to them. And I was asking God just to confirm that this was right, this is what I was meant to be doing. Well, the friends in Beijing particularly, again, really urged me to come and see them. So I took that as confirmation. And so I said to them, well, actually, I think this might be possible now. So since then, I've been looking into it, looking at what the possible costs might be.
Mm.
And just this last week, I've been trying to fill in the application form for a visa, because you need a visa to get into China, and it's quite a complicated process filling that in. I have to have a letter of invitation from my friends there.
Wow.
So there's quite a lot of things you've got to do before you can get there.
Yeah. And how long are you hoping to stay there for?
I'm thinking about 4 weeks.
Okay.
Nice. So I would go to Beijing, to Shanghai first, and then go to my friends in Beijing.
Lovely. Well, look, Dorothy, it sounds like you're a very well-travelled person. Is there anywhere else particularly exotic or strange that God has brought you to?
Well, I think the strangest place I've been, I mean, I have been to various places, and the reason why I'm wearing this shirt is because one of the first places God took me to was Egypt, with an organisation that specialises in taking you to places where Christians are having a hard time. And so I went to Egypt, first of all, and this is my name written in hieroglyphics.
Wow.
So I have to read it downwards.
Amazing.
And that says Dorothy in hieroglyphics. So that was one of the first places I went to, and saw what Christians were having to put up with there.
Mm.
And some of them are having quite a difficult time there. And I think it's got worse since I was there. I've also been to some African countries. But I think the strangest place was when I went to North Korea.
Wow.
Now, that was very strange because I was going thinking we'd have to be very quiet, not say anything about us being Christians, because in North Korea, the actual North Korean people cannot admit to being Christians at all. Otherwise, they risk being killed on the spot, even if they are just found with a Bible.
Yeah.
Or they will be taken off to one of their infamous labour camps. And not many of them come out of those camps again. And it can be the whole family, it can be the children, it can be the grandparents, because they assume something must be wrong with them for them to believe such a strange thing as being Christians. Anyway, when we got there, they assume, because you're a Westerner, and particularly if you're from Britain, that you must be Christians. They just assume that. So in fact, they let us prayer walk round that huge big parade ground that is in the centre of the capital. You see it on the television when they have their military displays.
Yeah.
It's a colossal big open square. And every evening when we were in the capital, they took us there by the coach and let us prayer walk. Mm. I think they probably thought we were wasting our breath, but they knew we were praying. But they made sure there was nobody else around.
Yeah.
And the security was extremely high. I mean, they took our passports off as the moment we got to the hotel.
Yes.
And they told us we mustn't go out of the hotel without them with us.
Yes.
So you knew you were being very closely watched. And we'd already been warned before we ever got into North Korea.
Yeah.
To be very careful. What we said, we knew our rooms would have listening apparatus in them. We were told we mustn't even get anywhere near talking about the company we've gone with. We had to use pseudonyms for certain things that we wanted to talk about. So there were certain words we never mentioned. We could talk about things in a covert way.
Sure.
We were told as well, the three people who were our guides, there was an older man and a very young man and a young woman who took the lead in terms of being our guides, but we were told they were actually security people, highly trained security people, and they would try bit by bit to get information from each of us and then put it all together to work out why we were really there.
Yeah.
So we had to be extremely careful how we answered them when they just chatted to us in a very friendly way, but be careful because they're actually highly trained security people.
That's amazing.
So they were really like guards.
Yeah.
And they said, you will not go out of this hotel without us. And they never gave you a chance to speak to any ordinary people on the street. They made sure you never had any contact with other people. So it was a very unreal situation. They were telling you all the time what a wonderful country it was and how happy everyone was. And yet you knew that you were being told lies the whole time, that it just wasn't true. What you've been shown was there for your benefit, and what people were being set up. We were taken to a farm, and you were shown a model farmer's house. And in every home in the country, there is a wall in the house. Everybody has to do this, where you have two pictures. One of the first great leader, Kim, whatever his name was, the first Kim, who is now the grandfather of the present leader, and the next leader, who is the father of the present leader. Wow. Those two photos must be on your wall, and no other things are on that wall. And somebody will come round periodically and check that you are keeping those pictures pristine, nicely dusted, and looked after. And if they aren't, you're in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And every home in the country has to have a wall with those two pictures on it. And we saw them in this farmer's house. And there's all sorts of rules like this. And there are two giant statues. And I say giant statues, they're colossal gold statues of them in the capital. And people have to go up and bow before these two statues. And they have to be neatly dressed, make sure the coats are fastened up, or the cardigans, and present flowers in front of these statues. Wow. Now, we were allowed not to do that because the leader of our group knew the older man who was one of our guides, knew him very well, and was able to negotiate with him that we didn't have to do that. But other groups that I know that have gone, they had to find some way of doing that without feeling they compromised as Christians.
Wow.
Because really it's a form of worship.
Definitely.
So it's a fine line to walk sometimes without offending the authorities.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's like if you were to try and, is that the same like system of being able to visit, but it's very like, you're not really being shown the true side of things. Is that like still how it is today if you went, or are you not allowed at all? Or if you went, if you wanted to go to North Korea today, what would it be like? Is it?
Oh, I think it's still like that.
Yeah.
And you see, the population are completely sealed off from the outside world. They are being told how privileged they are to live in North Korea. Because I've read a lot of books as well about from people and heard the testimony of people who have managed to escape. And they know nothing about the outside world because they're not allowed any internet connection with the outside world. So they know nothing about the outside world. They are told that North Korea is a beautiful place and the outside world is a terrible place.
Yeah.
And they are very fortunate to be there. And yet the people are starving. They are much smaller than other nations round about, even smaller than Chinese people. And they don't realise until perhaps they escape, because they're so undernourished.
Yeah.
And they, you know, those that have escaped have suddenly realised that they are smaller simply because they're so undernourished.
Yeah.
You know, there's reports that the government have issued instructions of how to cut grass to eat.
That's insane.
Because they've got, you know, any food that's imported goes to the army.
Yeah.
Because they feed their army, first of all and foremost. But a lot of the population are starving. And yet they are told, you know, this is a wonderful country. Yeah. You are much better off because you are in North Korea.
So, last Equipping Sunday, Dorothy, we had a meeting with Rob, the lovely Rob.
Mm-hmm.
And he was talking about like, what is the church? And so we were just wondering, all these amazing places you've been to, what is, like, how does that contrast to the church that we go to here?
Oh, well, in North Korea, I'll tell you, we had a very strange experience of church because they wanted to prove to us that they had freedom of religion. So they took us to a church on a Sunday morning, but it was a pretend church. They had people there sitting in the pews, and a choir, fully robed choir, and it was all an act.
Like, I mean,
you could tell that it was people who had been paid to be there to act as church congregation. And there were no children there, of course. And the people were all sitting nicely spaced along the pews. And of course, nothing was translated for us, so it was all in Korean.
Yeah.
And you could just tell it wasn't real.
Yeah.
What the choir was singing and what the guy at the front was talking about, we don't know. But it was all done to convince us that they had church services.
Yeah.
But the person who was the leader of our group, she said, but watch their faces, meaning particularly the ones we could see in the choir. She said, you might see somebody who's trying to tell you something with their eyes. There might be somebody who is a real Christian there, and they're trying to tell us something with their eyes. So we watched. And we all spotted one lady in the choir. And we all agreed she was trying to convey something to us with her eyes.
Wow.
So that's as near as you could get to making contact with the Christians.
That's incredible.
She would be risking her life doing that. Yeah. But everybody else, you know, they were all sitting about 18 inches apart, not in family groups at all, you know, and they were all in their traditional costume, all looking terribly smart. No, I mean, it just looks so artificial. Mm. Now, that's in contrast to churches I've been in Africa. Mm. When I was in Ghana, they wanted us to dress in their national costume, so I did. I bought some Ghanaian dress, and we all set to and danced around the room with the people in Accra in Ghana, and we had a great time. And they thought it was wonderful because we joined in with their African dancing.
Yeah, amazing.
It was great, yeah.
It sounds like you've been to some of the most extraordinary churches in the world. How did you find yourself at the OAKS Community Church?
How did I find it? Yeah.
What made you end up here?
When I first came to Dromfield, I was aware that there were quite a number of quite large churches in Dromfield, so I thought I will go around several churches and see where I just feel God is connecting me.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think Dromfield's very blessed with quite a number of lively churches, isn't it? But what I liked about the OAKS when I came here was this attitude that, you know, if God is telling us to do something, never mind what we've always done, we'll go for it.
Yeah.
If God's telling us to do something, let's go for it, you know.
Yeah.
It's not of this attitude, oh, well, we've always done it this way, so I think we better always keep doing it this way. It's none of that attitude, is there?
No.
So, soon after I came here, it was when Andy was leading the church, and we had that big giveaway. I don't know if you remember that. We gave away all the money we got saved for buying a new building, and we signed checks to all sorts of different charities, because Andy felt God had said to him that we got to give away our safety net. And so we decided what charities, we all discussed it and decided what charities to give the money to. And we signed all these checks, and then we had a party to celebrate. And I thought, yes, I like that.
Amazing. Dorothy, we've got an interesting question for you now.
So, Dorothy Higgins.
Yes.
What is your favourite noise?
Favourite noise. Well, I know one noise I like. You know when it's been very frosty?
Yeah.
If you go out in the country where there's been little shallow puddles where people have walked in the mud, and you get a thin layer of ice.
Yeah.
And I love to crunch on those. It's a really loud crunchy sound on the very thin ice. Yes, yeah. I love that.
Lovely. Good choice.
What's your least favourite noise? Mine's probably like a...
Oh, yeah.
I hate really noisy, loud motorbikes roaring up.
Yeah. I know the kind.
What's your least favourite?
Your fingers scratching down and... They don't have blackboards now, do they?
No, for that exact reason, that's why they outlawed them.
Do they?
What's your favourite?
My least favourite noise... more of like a high pitch, like a... just like a constant, really irritating noise like that.
Right, we've got one last question, is it? Do you want to go ahead?
No, sorry, it's your question, right. Jack.
So, would you rather? It's would you rather.
All right, go on then.
Only eat butter.
For the rest of your life.
Or stub your toe once.
Eat butter for the rest of my life.
Really?
Yeah, I love butter.
Well, butter is nice.
Butter.
Slap on the butter, I think.
Good choice, Dorothy. Yeah.
It's been a pleasure having you.
It's been an absolute pleasure.
Good to talk to you.
It's been very interesting.
You're welcome back anytime.
You've got so many stories to tell. We've really enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
Good to talk.
Thank you.
Wow. Dorothy, what a legend. So interesting. Genuinely, I know you already said it, but probably the best interview we've ever had. No disrespect, of course, to our previous guests. Yeah. You're all amazing.
We still love you,
Campbell. And speaking of a way to, like, honour our guests, Jack, is there something you want to say?
There is. A new series of Oaks Online means a new fantastic feature. After every interview, we're going to print out a little frame for them. There you go, look at that. To add to the wall of fame.
The wall of
fame. Do you want to do the honours?
Oh, you are very kind.
And we're going to keep it here for all of time so everyone can see. On she goes.
There we go. Dorothy Higgins.
So if you want your picture on there, can we get interviewed by me and Josh?
Get in touch or leave a comment below saying, me, me, me. And we will get you an interview. Fantastic. Thanks again, Dorothy, for coming on. That was fantastic. And all the best of luck as you travel to China.
Wow. This is a pretty beautiful building, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's a great Oaks Community Church.
Oaks Community what?
Oaks Community Church.
What?
What do you mean?
Oaks Community what?
Church.
What is the church?
I hadn't thought of that.
Oh, well, ladies and gents, that question is going to be answered in the discussion that we've got with the lovely Emma and the even lovelier Julia.
Communion.
This is how God.
I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father.
Hello everyone and welcome to this episode's Bible Talk discussion. This week we are looking at what is the church and what is the purpose of the church. This is something we've been considering as a church over the past couple of months. And so Julia, kick us off with what is the church?
Well, it's not a building.
No. Definitely not a building. Hopefully everyone knew that already going into that session.
I have reflected a bit over the years that although we all know that the church isn't a building, and actually where we meet here in Drumfield is actually called
The building. Yeah.
To kind of reinforce that, I think sometimes we inadvertently pay lip service to that. Because we'll talk about going to church.
I do that all the time.
So then it suddenly slips back into that place where we gather, when in fact it's us, isn't it? It's the body of Christ, it's us as individuals, and when we meet together in twos and threes, in wherever and for whatever, to fellowship.
Yeah, I think when Rob did the teaching, he did a sheet, didn't he? And it was like,
yes.
Is this church? Yes or no? And then he had like different statements.
Yeah.
And if you weren't there, you can go on the website and you can listen to Rob's teaching and you can also do this exercise. And it is fascinating because there was stuff on there. I was like, I think I know what church is. Like, I went into that session maybe a bit too cocky. And when we did that, I was like, wow, no, I don't know. Because the one thing that struck me about it the most was how, like, we know that the church is the people, we don't call the building the church and all that, but it was like, I like the word ecclesia, which is what the Greek word is, because it just shifts in my head, like, you wouldn't go to ecclesia, so I need to start using that word instead, because it's like, the word church has so many connotations now, that even to the world it has connotations. Mm. Some positive, some negative, not saying it's all bad, but it does. I shared, didn't I, in that session that a lady who recently became a Christian in our ecclesia said that when I told her that the building wasn't a church, it was like the church's best kept secret.
Mm-hmm.
And she's never heard us say that this is a church, this building. So it's just crazy, really. People pick up on it even though we don't say it.
Yeah. Well, I think culturally, even people that have absolutely no faith interest or faith experience would look at a building like this and say it's church.
Yeah.
It's just part of our cultural, I don't know, lexical, whatever, understanding. And so it comes loaded with meaning, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So that's what we're unpacking with.
Yes. So if you haven't had a chance to look at that yet, please go to our website and find that. It's really good. Rob did an excellent job at unpacking it and helping us think, even if we thought we knew, like me, then we didn't. So be challenged by that.
Be challenged.
Then we're filming this on Monday. Yesterday we had another equipping meeting, which is where we basically take a deep dive into what the Bible says about topics, and we touched on what is the purpose of church. A bit different.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Anything you want to say about that?
I think it's that having to rethink as well our maybe habits that we've got into, or things that we think is right. But like we looked into the Greek word for church, which was ecclesia, which, and it, I should say, it means called out and gathered, because it was a very secular thing back in ancient Greece or ancient whatever back in the day. So it was about anybody who was being called out into the public space, so being called out and gathered, and then that's likened to us being called out of the world into the kingdom of God and gathering. So it really doesn't matter where it is. So yesterday when we were talking about the purpose of church, we got onto discipleship, and again the Greek root of the word discipleship, and it just shifts things slightly and sort of messes with your head, because you have to rethink things that perhaps you've always accepted.
Yeah.
So we had a huge debate, didn't we?
You rang. No, let's tell the truth. You rang me the Friday before us standing to teach on the Sunday, like, I can't. What do you mean? Why have you written this? That's surely heresy.
It's because we were referring to Matthew 28, 18 to 20, with Jesus saying, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples of all nations." And it was this make disciples, but we know from our studying and our thinking, actually we can't make disciples.
You can. This is literally what happened. So, yeah. My understanding is, and I'm willing to be challenged, please come and talk to me about this, is that the actual act of becoming a disciple, so like when I put my faith in Jesus when I was 21, best decision I ever made, that act was like a spiritual thing. Like it's, you couldn't do it to me.
No.
Even I couldn't do it to me.
No.
Only God can do it. Mm-hmm. And we know that. Mm. Like we say, only God saves, we sing about it. I think we know that ultimately.
Yeah.
So I don't think that that's what Jesus is saying. No. It's not like, you know, it's on us. Because I think on Sunday I read out of John 10, which we all know, like, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd." Mm. It's that passage, and which is an outrageous claim in itself, because in the Old Testament, God is known as the good shepherd. So it's like Jesus is claiming to be God, so even that in itself is outrageous. Mm. But the bit that I read was about how, you know, there are sheep that aren't part of this flock that will hear my voice and answer my call. Mm-hmm. So I don't think Jesus was ever saying that it was us that would cause people to become his disciples. You know, there was people that didn't respond to Jesus when he was there in front of them.
Yeah.
He said to them that, you know, think of like the rich guy who loved money more than God. And he said, "What, I've done all of your commands, what do I need to do?" And Jesus is like, "Sell all your possessions." And he's like, I can't. So it's not, and that doesn't mean we have to sell all our possessions. I think for that guy, it was money was above God.
He knew his
God.
Weakness. Yeah.
In other passages, like I think it was mentioned yesterday, Stephen mentioned it about, you know, hate your mother and your father. Like, Jesus isn't wanting you to hate your mother and your father, obviously, but it's like, if anything comes between you and God, that's not okay. You know, God has to come first. If God is love and he loves us, we can't love other people unless he is first in our lives, basically, is what I'm understanding of this. So when Jesus said go and make disciples, I think it's like we forget that at that point only Jews were allowed to know God. Right. They were his chosen people.
Mm.
And I think what Jesus is saying is like, now everyone can have a restored relationship with Jesus if they want, if they opt into that free gift of salvation. And it's not just about the Jewish people anymore. Mm. Because obviously in the early church it was mostly Jews that they were talking to, and then spread it along around the world. Mm. So I think Jesus is talking about it's much wider, you know. Yeah. God is for everyone. You can be in any culture and it'd be fine. That's what I mean by this.
Yes.
Yeah. But you got bogged down, I think, by that word make, didn't you?
Because disciple, to disciple, it's not a verb.
No.
So it's not a, you know, you either are or you aren't, but you can't make it. You can't disciple somebody, even though we use that language all the time.
Yeah, we do.
And that's what really tripped me up. And I was thinking, well, what can you use instead of the word disciple? And it was follower or whatever. But then you still got this make. And it was only when you told me about the Greek roots that actually it's not a good translation. So it's actually translated as make disciples. It's two words instead of one.
Yeah.
I
think I might have said it was a bad translation. I don't think that's what I meant. I think what I meant was that English doesn't translate to Greek, like the ancient Greek. There's not word. I imagine any language is like this. You know, if you had someone who was really clever and they could speak two languages, I'm sure we must know people that do that and they could maybe back this up. Sometimes the way you say a phrase in English, it just doesn't translate.
Yeah.
So the closest thing, I think I explained to you, like in the Greek, there's like four words for the word love. I think it is. And we have one. Mm-hmm. And I would say I love you and I love ice cream. Mm-hmm. Hopefully I don't love those, you and ice cream, in the same way. That would be probably not
ice cream
is the ball. You get what I'm saying though. It's like we just can't. Yeah. It's just because it's a different language. Like, it's not because it's a bad translation, so forgive me if I said that. I think it's the best we can do, and there's obviously amazing scholars that are translating things, but I'm not a person that's like, you must read this translation, because ultimately, they're all translations.
Yeah.
Unless you can read it in the original Greek,
you
read the one that you find most helpful.
I suppose it depends where it lands, because that, for me, I know you've already said it's not our responsibility, God calls people, but I think some people can get bogged down with that expectation and striving, you must go out and do this.
Yeah.
And actually that's not it at all. We're just called to serve and witness and what have you, not to pursue someone and coerce them into the kingdom.
I honestly don't believe you could coerce anyone into the kingdom. I think ask people in your belonging group or your friends down the pub, whatever, what made then become a Christian. I don't think that people would ever say that they were won over into the kingdom of God. It's a spiritual thing.
I think some people can go through the motions though, because
yeah, of course you can, as in you have. I was like spiritually hungry, I would say, and I would ask Linda, my friend, some questions perhaps, and she would answer them. Mm. And I think that's what the Bible says, we need to be ready to defend our faith at any moment. And we obviously have to evangelize and witness and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Even the word evangelize now, to me, I feel like it's got such negative connotations, but there is good news. We have good news to share, and we should be willing to share it. And so it's not just like, I'm not advocating we don't say anything, which maybe might be helpful to explain what I actually put together for the things that what makes us a disciple.
Yeah.
Now, this came out of a Bible study at my belonging group, so this is where these four things come from.
Mm-hmm.
So I haven't made them up or anything. It was from there. Well, I basically copied them from that. So it was what makes us a disciple, which I think is the purpose of why we are church. We have to be a disciple.
Yeah.
That's our purpose now. Mm-hmm. If you have been saved by Jesus, your purpose in life now is to be a disciple. That's what I believe. A
follower of Jesus.
An apprentice, a follower, whatever word you want to use.
Yeah.
So it's, in my opinion, and probably the opinion of my belonging group, baptised into Christ.
Yeah.
As I said, that's the bit that I don't think we have any power over.
Mm.
Because if we do, we're entering into a kind of a works-based gospel.
Mm.
So I think that's not true.
Mm.
So there's a quote, isn't there, that we put in by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, which is, salvation is free, but discipleship will cost you your life. Mm. If we try and think that we can work our way into the kingdom somehow, then we've not understood the cost that Jesus paid on the cross, mm-hmm. if that makes sense. So that's number one, mm-hmm. baptised into Christ, which only God can do. Mm-hmm. It's like a spiritual rebirth of us. Number two was surrendered lives. So that's quite a challenge, because even when you may have been, you've given your life to Jesus, I think sometimes surrendering your life to him is a bit like on a bungee cord, isn't it? You like surrender something and you're like, no, I'll just have that back. No, I'll just have it back.
Well, then you surrender one bit and then you discover that there's another thing, you know, you just think you've got it sorted and then you realise
there's not, this isn't an ordered thing.
No.
I think the first one is, like, that's the first thing, you have to have a relationship with Jesus, but the other three are like long-term
journeying
things. Daily things, battles sometimes.
Yeah.
So yeah, surrendered lives, so baptising to Christ, surrendered lives. Mm-hmm. Number three, developing spiritual disciplines,
mm-hmm.
Which I will read out what we have decided through various sources, but essentially Richard Foster's spiritual disciplines, but then there's also a few other people that have
more contemporary.
Taken him. Yeah, so it's like we've looked at
John
Ortberg.
Mm-hmm.
Life I've Always Wanted,
mm-hmm.
classic.
Yeah,
I love that. If you're a person who likes John Ortberg, go and read that.
Mm-hmm.
Also, more recently and more relevant perhaps to today, because it's just coming out, it's a series by John Mark Comer,
mm-hmm.
called Practicing the Way, and he doesn't call them spiritual disciplines; he calls them spiritual practices.
Mm-hmm.
But they're the same thing essentially.
Yeah.
And the final thing was loving one another radically. And this was specifically, more specifically, about loving each other within the ecclesia.
Mm.
Because Jesus says, you know, by this, by loving one another is how you'll be known to the world.
Mm.
And I don't think Christians are known for their love sometimes.
At the moment.
Of one another.
Yeah.
You know, if we think more nationally and globally.
Mm.
Especially in America at the moment, I feel like the word Christian is a bit of a swear word.
Bad word. But it was very politicised
and
polarised in America. And I think that's one of the issues, isn't it? It's about, and I think that's what's been coming out of the stuff that we've been reading. There are people who would call themselves a Christian. Perhaps could they've been born into a Christian family, they've gone to church.
Yeah.
But actually that transformation, maybe they have been baptised into Christ, we can't say, we don't know. But that transformation, you know, when the rubber hits the road, do they look and sound and act like Jesus? Maybe not. And that's for all of us, isn't it?
That's been the challenging thing of for me as we've been preparing this. Like, am I actually a disciple?
Mm.
You know,
mm.
when I read about this and the Bible and think like what it actually means to follow Jesus, mm. am I living my life like that? I don't think...
Not always.
Well, no, I don't actually know if I know a disciple. Like, that's what my friend and I were literally talking about
mm-hmm.
last week when we went in from my belong group talking about this. Like, are any of us actually disciples when you look at what this stuff means? It's so challenging and radical.
Yeah.
So, before we finish, the spiritual practices, disciplines, whatever you want to call them,
mm-hmm.
That we've settled on are these from John Mark Comer.
Mm-hmm.
Which are Sabbath, prayer, fasting, solitude, mm-hmm. generosity, scripture, community, service, and witness.
Mm.
And I said yesterday, because I don't know about you, but when I read these sorts of things, I'm like, red flag, help me, I'm such a bad Christian, I don't do any of these things. Well, obviously I do some of them, but I don't do some of them in great measure. I confessed yesterday that solitude, terrifying.
Wow.
Terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that for me. Really scary, but we're in training, we're not in trying.
And that's the difference between actually calling them disciplines and practices, isn't it? Practicing, you just, you're having a go, you fail, you have another go.
Yeah.
And there's a discipline within that, and that practice, it just comes naturally, doesn't it? If you keep practicing at something, playing an instrument, doing a sport,
you get better.
You do get better. And we don't want to be hard on ourselves, but actually it's important that we do have a go, don't we? And for me, that's what the Bonhoeffer quote is about, because you know, we're all saved, yay, and then we go off and carry on doing exactly the same things. So 30 years after being a Christian, you're still exactly the same person, or a very similar person to when you became a Christian. That's quite sad.
Mm-hmm. You know, not living in the freedom.
Not living in the freedom and fruit and what have you. So it's really getting a handle on how we can get a handle without becoming legalistic, without becoming religious, without...
Yeah.
Yeah, the downside.
And that's what I think is key to remember, why we're in training, we're not trying. Because if you are trying and you feel you aren't achieving, you will become legalistic, or you will feel like a failure or whatever. But if actually you're in training, you're not going to feel as much like that, are you?
No. I have your bike analogy. Can you share your bike analogy?
My bike analogy? Yeah. I ride a bike, not very well. I'm not very fast or anything. Don't really like going downhill, actually. Favourite problem around here when it's all hilly. But if I'm out on a bike ride, I'll be like, right, I don't know why I'm doing this, it's not how you ride a bike, like this. And I think I'll get to like the end of the ride and there'll be like a big hill, say, which, living in Dronfield, there are lots of big hills.
Mm.
And I might be like, oh, I can't be bothered to do it. But then I think to myself, why? Mm. Why does it matter whether I stop halfway up the hill or not? It really doesn't, it doesn't matter, because at least if I've, you know, gone halfway up,
mm-hmm.
I've gone halfway up.
Yeah.
And in a way, I'm in training. I'm probably fitter at this time of year because the hockey season's going and all that. But especially, you know, when you've not played sport in a while, or if you know, I don't know, if you run or something and then you don't run for a while and you go back to when it's really hard, like it's...
No, I do.
You're in training then, aren't you, to get fit again?
Yeah.
And that's how, I think Paul uses the analogy of running a race and stuff,
mm-hmm.
because it's such helpful imagery. If anyone's ever tried to train for any kind of sporting event,
mm-hmm.
that's how you to view your Christian life.
Mm-hmm.
And these spiritual practices are the ways that we train.
Yeah.
And if I'm not failing if I go out and I've done a ride, even if it's not very long, because that's better than not doing anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
So I've not failed.
No.
Whereas if I'm trying to cycle up a hill as fast as I can, if that's how I want to view it, if I don't do it right, I'm failing, aren't I, in my head?
Yeah.
But if I view it as training, mm-hmm. it's all training. It's all
good
stuff. So that's what I was on about.
Yeah.
But yeah. The only other thing I talked about, which we'll finish on, is about the spiritual disciplines bit,
mm-hmm.
is I talked about as being a tree,
mm-hmm.
which again came out of discussions with our belonging group, and how to stop ourselves falling into that legalistic religious thing of these spiritual disciplines. If you have the Holy Spirit in you,
mm-hmm.
you are a good tree.
Mm-hmm.
You're not like a bad tree anymore. Mm-hmm. You're a good tree. Your old self is dead and you're a new creation in Christ. That is all true.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't do these spiritual disciplines, you will still be a good tree, a bit like what you talked about with these Christian people who become a Christian and then don't change for 30 years.
Mm.
They're still saved if they have that, they believe they have had that spiritual rebirth, as we talked about, that's between them and God.
Yeah.
I do, you know, believe that. But a tree, given the right soil, the right nutrients, the right, you know, rain, a bit of pruning here and there, it will produce fruit.
Yeah.
And I think that's what is key to being a disciple, is if we really ask ourselves, like, am I a disciple? You let God in, you surrender your life to Him, all the other stuff will kind of take care of itself.
Mm.
You know, I think the Bible's quite clear about our faces will shine the glory of God, it says in 2 Corinthians. You know, that's what it means.
Mm.
If we are living in relationship, right relationship with God again, this is like Moses had to hide his face in the Old Testament that was shining after he encountered God on the mountain to have the Ten Commandments, or more than ten. Whereas we don't have to hide our face anymore. The veil is gone, you know. People will see the Holy Spirit in us radiating out.
Yeah.
Does that make, I feel like maybe that doesn't make sense, but that's how I'm kind of mulling it over in my head.
Because that's what you were saying about when you were sort of asking questions before you became a Christian, that it wasn't the person your friend that you found attractive. It was something within her which you now realise was the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. At the time, I just thought Linda was a bit quirky or something. I mean, she is quirky, but as in, I don't know. There was just something about the conversations that we had that seemed to stir me, and I would leave those conversations feeling like I wanted to know more, and like she just seemed to have this peace about her that I didn't understand. And now I'm a Christian too. I think I know that's the Holy Spirit in her. It wasn't her.
Yeah.
It was the Holy Spirit. But it's a spiritual thing. It's really hard to logically explain to people. I'm sure I can't be the only one that's had conversations with family and friends who aren't Christian, and they just look at you like you've got two heads, because it's really hard to tangibly explain that spiritual thing that occurs.
Awakening.
Yeah. Mm. You can't, can you?
No.
You can't logically explain it.
No.
So. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. But I think there is really much importance in having those conversations with people about why they believe what they believe, and because our faith is a... there are facts to our faith, you know, Jesus existed.
Mm.
No one, no historian would doubt that. No. You know, even Richard Dawkins, the great atheist, doesn't deny that Jesus actually existed. So there are facts to our faith.
Yeah.
I'm just talking about that spiritual rebirth that occurs.
Mm.
Can't be argued within me. Yeah. It's like a... Yeah.
It's a mystery.
It's a mystery. The mystery, well,
mystery.
Christ in us.
Yay.
Everybody. So... yeah, if you... Is there anything else you want to say, Julie, before we wrap up with that?
Don't think so, other than there's lots and lots of resources on our website.
Yes.
Both our stuff, home-produced stuff, and external stuff.
Much better than that.
External stuff. I think what fascinates me is that there's something happening, like, not just within the Oaks at the moment.
Yeah.
There's something bubbling. And there's so many speakers and books and, you know, people that have been, I don't know, pastors for donkey's years in the States are suddenly coming out and saying, actually, I've checked, something's changed.
Yeah.
And they're showing us the way that they've gone. And so the God's up to something. He's changing the gear, I think, and shifting the emphasis and getting us to just kind of shaking things up a bit and getting us to rethink perhaps habits and ways of thinking and ways of living that we've got into, and just accept.
Mm.
And actually, now is the time.
So we'll put the link to those below this video. Mm. But yeah, we recommend personally the John Mark Home stuff that's coming out, because Practicing the Way podcast is really all about this stuff, and it's really great. Get you thinking.
Mm.
But yeah, we'll see you next time.
Yeah, thanks for watching.
Okay, now is the time for the first edition of To Bible or Not To Bible. Ladies and gents, it is good to be back on this part of the show. We know you guys love it. And it's an important part as well, because we mustn't forget why we do it. To Bible or not to Bible, it's all about making sure we don't take the Bible out of context.
Right.
It's very easy to take little segments of that beautiful book, but twist them in awful ways. So we just really want to highlight how easy it is to get mixed up. And without further ado, let's have a quick flashback to last week's To Bible or not to Bible.
Okay, here's the first one, guys. Meaningless. Meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. Wow, that's the first one.
And the second verse is, we're the Christmas boys.
And we bring much joy for your baby.
Said the three wise men.
Wow, that is hard.
That has to be the hardest one.
I swear, we get harder every week.
That is.
I don't even remember that. I don't remember.
My money's on the one about the Christmas boys, but...
Well, that's real.
That's the real one.
Yeah,
but,
surely.
Okay, let's reveal the answer.
The correct answer was...
Oh!
Meaningless, meaningless. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless.
Wow. Oh. That is insane.
You got it wrong. Where's it from?
That is from Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 2.
Who would have thought?
Wow. Gonna have to read that one in full to truly understand the meaning behind the word meaningless in that particular one. But yeah, okay, and without further ado, guys, let's get straight on to this week's to Bible.
Or not to Bible. Okay. So the first Bible verse, or not Bible verse, is far outside of town where the grass never grows. And the wind smells so sour when it blows. And no birds ever sing except the old creaky crows.
Ah!
That's the place where Jesus lives.
Oh, wow.
Luke?
I was thinking Mark, but you know. Surely, surely. Okay, okay. And the next Bible verse is. Or not Bible verse. Is love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honouring each other. Okay, a little bit of a difficult one, that. I still don't think it's as hard as last week's.
No, not a Christian.
But that's a tricky one. If you know the answer, do leave a comment below. Best of luck, guys, and we will see you next week for more to Bible.
Or not to Bible.
Okay, thank you very much for watching the first episode of Series 6 of Oaks Online. It's been really good.
Yeah, thank you
for watching. And we'll see you on the next
week over Oaks Online. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah, that was okay, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Got it all
right.
I think. Happy with that.
Boys, I'm really sorry again, but it just took so long. It's like we've been here over half an hour to film a 3-minute section of video.
Well, I think we did all right. Okay, could have been
worse. Look, I've tried to... Look, John's even asleep.
John! What?
Sorry.
Have you finished?
Got
for that.
Sorry.
I've tried to explain to them that we really need them to, you know.
I know, we're going to have a team meeting about this.
Well, we have spoken.
In fact, I'll tell you what, you're fired! Get out!
What? John?
John?
Oh, bad enough.
You can't!
Yeah.
We've been on this show for what?
Fine.
Fired.
Sorry, boys. Nothing I can do.
But can you not? Oh. Bye, guys.
What a joke.
It's been fun.
I can't believe that's just happened. I really thought we didn't do that bad, to be honest.
Do you really think they'd fire us?
What do we do now?
You win some, you lose some, Jack. Well, I don't even know if I'm going to have a home after.
I don't know. It pays the bills, doesn't it?
I was. Well,
I guess
it's the streets for us, Jack.
Yeah, it must be. Right. Anyone got any money?
Money! Money!
100 This is everything you ever wanted. One moment. Would you capture it? Or just let it slip?
Impressive.
Lose yourself in the music the moment you want it. You better never let it go.